شاء الله continue. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد الناصح الأمين وعلى آله الغر الميامين وأصحابه نجوم الدين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وعنا معهم برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. So now inshallah after finishing the text of حديث سيدنا ابن عباس by إمام الترمذي we'll speak about the adding or the extra of those phrases you know mentioned by another famous muhaddith called Abd ibn Humayd. As Imam Nawawi said, other than Tirmizi, you have احفظ الله تجده أمامك تعرف إلى الله في الرخاء يعرفك في الشدة فعلم أن ما أخطأك لم يكن ليصيبك وما أصابك لم يكن ليخطئك واعلم أن النصر مع الصبر وأن الفرج مع الكرب وأن مع العسر يسرا. So here the first phrase احفظ الله تجده أمامك it sounds too similar to the phrase that we have in the previous hadith احفظ الله تجده تجاهك. So I'm not going to explain it a lot, you know, just remember what we have said about the previous one. Then Alhamdulillah, I'm too happy. Perhaps I paid my attention to it right now, you know, because always or for a while, you know, I have a lot of concern about knowledge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I feel myself too poor, you know, in it and would like to get more and more. And here the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told you about very smart and very intelligent way, you know, of gaining the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is going to be also practical for you when he said, تعرف إلى الله في الرخاء. You want to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Try to expose, تعرف. تعرف in Arabic language, whenever you have this verb, this setting of the verb تفعل, means you should do work hard. You should show your efforts, okay? That means, I may express it as expose, have significant exposure to get knowledge about Allah in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala during the good times, the happy time. How? By looking at the favors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, looking at the actions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Try to know the mercy of Allah, the generosity of Allah, and you name it. Try to apply all of those 99 names and the others, the attributes, the actions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Try to match whatever you know to according to some verses of the Quran, some traditions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, especially some of those ahadith qudsiya that we mentioned about before. And by this, when you have this significant exposure, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to know you when you have some unhappy event or bad dates, you know, or hardship, or whatever of that regard. And be sure, and this is very important to us because you see, any of us in this life, we are going to be exposed to happy and unhappy events, to what we like and dislike. And this is the fact of this life. And this is by itself is a favor from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because just imagine if everything was going to go according to whatever you wish or whatever you love in this life, you know, what's the result of it? You will not like to move from this life. You want to stay here forever. Okay? And by this you are going to miss not something, this is everything. You are going to miss everything, you know. To meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the best, okay? And if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made this life, you know, just the easiest, you know, for us, He is capable of doing this, you know, but this is not good for us. That's why in one hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Allah protect His slave from dunya the way you protect your patient of eating some matters, some materials, like salt for the hypertensive one, sugar for the diabetic one, and you name it. How you, this is a very dear person to you, how you prevent him of eating salt or eating sugar or you name it, you know. In the same way, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even though everything is available to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and under His power subhanahu wa ta'ala, but He yet sometimes stop giving this to certain people as a protection of this dunya. Why? Because when we love this dunya a lot, this is going to be the main and major barrier, you know, to gain the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we will not like to move to elsewhere, you know, which is much better for us, you know, than this life. So that's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam reminded us about something we believe in it. We believe in the predestination, the decree of us, you know. And here it's mentioned, be sure whatever happened to you is not going to miss you. Whatever missed you is not going to happen to you. And I look at it, you know, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam put it in the past tense setting, you know, just to tell you this about the past, not about the future. Why not about the future? Because for that future, since you don't know what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wrote for you, you should work hard. Okay? And here you have different look. Whatever happened to you, when you look at the past, you have it with full belief and full acceptance, full submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because you know now, for sure you know now, that this is the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But for the future, since you don't know, you should work hard. You should show your efforts in this regard. I think that's why it was put in this setting, you know, but in the past tense, you know, وَعْلَمْ أَنَّ مَا أَخْطَأَكَ, whatever missed you is not going to hit you or reach you, and vice versa. Then the Prophet ﷺ gave us something just to have good thoughts about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Here we are not children. You know, that child, if you frown at him, you know, he's going to run away. If you give him candy, he's going to come and love you a lot, you know. If you are a child, you are going to have the same pattern with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No, you are not a child, right? So that's why we should stick to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Be in touch with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala all the time, regardless. Your relation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is much superior than job, than wife, than work, than you name it, you know, all of those matters. They are way down. They are inferior, you know. Your relation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala should be much more superior than all of these matters, you know. And perhaps that's what we were told by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which may be against our thought of many of us, you know, when he said, أَشَدُّكُمْ بَلَاءً الْأَنْبِيَاءُ الْأَمْثَلُ فَالْأَمْثَلُ. Yeah, the most among us who they are going to be exposed to those temptations, you know, and you may call it disaster or unhappy events, you know, they are the prophets, which perhaps against what in my mind, you know. Why? Because those people, their relation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is much superior than those matters. So here, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave us the combination not to be sad about anything. You should be happy. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tries to make himself known by you, by those matters. Either by happy one, to know or figure out some of his attributes, or the unhappy one, to make you familiar or more knowledgeable about some of his holy names or holy attributes in the same pattern, you know. That's why he put the combination, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that nasr ma'a sabr, victory or support. Nasr may mean in Arabic again support, not necessarily to mean victory. Support, it may mean support, you know. Support is given by patience, okay? And this remind me of the other hadith when the Prophet ﷺ said, no one has been given anything broader or wider than patience, because you need patience, you know, in all aspects of your life. In the happy event, to control yourself, not to go beyond the rank, not to commit sin, not to do this, not to speak up about yourself frequently, not to be pride, and you need it in the same meanwhile, whenever you have disaster, whenever you have negative event, you name it, you know. In all of those matters, you need sabr, you know. And here, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, whenever you try to have this sabr, how I'll get sabr? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, وَمَنْ يَتَصَبَّرْ يُصَبِّرْهُ اللَّهُ. He's going to try to subject, to work hard, you know, on himself, you know, to be patient. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to give him patience Okay, and in this way, whenever you are given the patience from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, be sure, don't be in doubt, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, support from Allah is going to accompany, is going to join this. And in the same maneuver, faraja ma'a al-karb, yani whenever you feel your chest tight, you know, you feel the heaviness of the events surrounding you, be sure that the relief from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is accompanying this ma' with. Yeah, he did not say coming soon or what. No, he said with. Yeah, you are going to have the relief. You are going to have the good news from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala very quickly. And this mentioned in another hadith. عجب ربك من قنوط عباده وقرب غيره. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gets surprised. We don't know how, you know, this is Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala surprised about what? When the people or the slaves, they became despair, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was quite, and in very soon time, very close time or very soon is going to change this غيره, and to change it, okay? Yeah, you have the person significantly despaired and the relief is too close, very soon it's about to come, okay? So it's a matter of just hold, cool yourself, be patient little bit, and you are going to see, okay? وأن مع العسر يسرا. Yani, whenever you have hardship, you know, or any of those difficulties, you know, be sure that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to supply with a lot of ease, a lot of help, you know, to make you. And here it's mentioned once in the Holy Quran, it's mentioned twice. And this is narrated, I think, by that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, since it's mentioned twice, that you have total of two eases. And you are not going to find one difficulty, you know, get over two eases. You know, always Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala support you, give you the easy life, give you the help that you need, okay? But we tend as human always to be quick, you know, and we want everything to happen fast to us. And this quickness is not a good matter, you know, to have it all the time. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَخُلِقَ الْإِنسَانُ عَجُولًا. This one of the characters or the type of the personality, the person they have, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not going to go according to it. And this, to be quick or fast, in those certain matters, it's condemned, especially for dua. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, one of the major barrier of having the dua accepted, when the person make dua and say, I had made dua, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not answer me, did not accept my dua. This is one of the major barrier, you know, of doing dua. By this, inshallah, not finished, started this hadith, okay? We'll start this hadith, okay? And I consider this as an explanation of the summary of the second hadith, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam defined al-ihsan, the perfection, you know, that to observe of Allah as if you see him. If you don't see him, for sure he sees you. So here you may consider this as little bit give you more information, more knowledge, you know, about this point of ihsan, which inshallah is going to strengthen our knowledge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, strengthen about our confidence in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and do you name it. And again, I end speaking about this hadith by said, what a night was to Sayyidina Ibn Abbas. Okay. Move to next hadith. عن أبي مسعود عقبة بن عمرو الأنصاري البدري رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إن مما أدرك الناس من كلام النبوة الأولى إذا لم تستحي فاصنع ما شئت. رواه البخاري.
حديث 20 on the authority of أبو مسعود عقبة بن عمرو الأنصاري البدري may Allah be pleased with him, who said the messenger of Allah may the blessing of Allah be upon him said, among the words people obtain from the first prophecy are, if you feel no shame, then do as you wish. It was related by Abu Qatada.
سيدنا أبو مسعود البدري, one of the Ansar, he was the youngest to attend بيعة العقبة الكبرى. He was the youngest among them, سيدنا أبو مسعود البدري. He is given the name Badri even though according to majority of the scholars or most of them, he did not attend Badr. According to Imam Bukhari, he attended Badr, but most of scholars, they said, no, he did not attend Badr, but was called Al-Badri because he lived in that area, you know, for a while, and that's why he was called Al-Badri. He narrated, I think, if I'm right, roughly 102 hadith, and 102 hadith, you know, from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Sayyidina Mas'ud al-Badri, and this is one of his hadith. إِنَّ مِمَّا أَدْرَكَ النَّاسُ مِنْ كَلَامِ النُّبُوَّةِ الْأُولَى. Okay, what I want to comment here, that firstly, this is a reminder what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has been instructed in the Quran, فَبِهُدَاهُ مُقْتَدِهُ. يعني he combined or collected all guidances of all prophets, you know, in his guidance and in his personality, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this is a reminder of it, you know. Here he conveyed to us something of what has what the previous nation they have been instructed or what they have been told. As when you recite in Surah Al-A'la, إن هذا لفي الصحف الأولى صحف إبراهيم وموسى, or in Surah Al-Najm, the same way, or whatever, you know. Or when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as in that long hadith of Sayyidina Abu Dharr, he was asked about what's written in Suhuf Ibrahim and Musa, and he told him about certain phrases, you know, from there, you know. All those matters tells us that this is some of what mentioned, you know, in the previous book, or the previous nation, they were told about it, you know, and this has been conveyed to us by our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The second point that I would like to highlight is an-nubuwwah, prophethood. Okay, a famous scholar, he said, all of us we are going to be weighed in the hereafter according to four items. First item, our belief, iman. The second item, I don't know, you call it friendship or loyalty to Allah, wilaya. The third item, prophethood. The fourth item, message or risala. Are you messengers or prophets? You should have some portion of it. What portion you should have? And here, for message, your presence here is to have part, your portion of message. Inshallah, if you hear those ahadith and you got it and try to spread it to someone else, to your family, to your neighbors, to your friends, to your community, you name it, you know, you are holding part of the message. Okay, this is part of the message. And this is your inheritance from the message of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Okay. Do you have your portion of prophethood? Yes. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, one hadith said, dream, when it's from Allah, it's one of 46 portion, you know, of prophethood. And those who have those clear and truthful dreams, you know, they have significant share or significant portion of the prophethood. No revelation, but they have portion of prophethood. They have, and the other hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, al-iqtisad, to be modest, wal-hadi, to be guided, was-samt al-hasan, when you are in good way and nice looking, you know, these are one of 20th portion of the prophethood. And another hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, whoever memorized the whole Quran as if the prophethood is among his shoulders, but there is no revelation. Okay, so see, these are the portions of prophethood. And what I understand, I may be wrong, when he said min kalam an-nubuwwati al-ula, this is part of the prophethood. What? To be ashamed, to be shy. Okay, this حياء, we call it in Arabic. This is part of the prophethood. This remind me that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was described كان أشد حياء من العذراء في خدرها. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم will be shy much more than the in those old days, الله يرحمه ديك الأيام, when the woman, she used to stay at home, you know, and she is shy from anything, you know. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was much more shy than those old women that we don't have them nowadays, okay? So why I should mention this? And now we are aware that we are going to be scaled according to these four items. Just try to fix them, okay? Whenever you have anything by chain, this is part of your message. Try to learn Quran, try to learn Hadith, try to learn fiqh and try to convey this, and this is part of your message, you know. You are, this is going to come to improve your scale, you know, in message for sure. All of us, since no more prophet or no more messenger after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we are going to be deficiently weighed down, you know, at this, but at least we should have significant portion of the message of prophethood. Besides, we may have, we may have it all, inshallah, you know, regarding our belief and our friendship to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or wilayah. So here, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in this particular hadith said, whoever is not shy of something, let him do whatever he wants to do. And this is was understood by the scholar by two different ways. The first way that the one who doesn't have this character, shyness, or let him do whatever he wants to do, and this is like a threatening, like when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said i'malu ma shi'tum, this is a threatening from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Is it not a permission to do whatever he wants to do? This is one understanding. The other understanding of this hadith, that if you did not do something that considered as shame doing or shame action, you know, according to our Islamic standard, do it. No problem about it. So, and by this, you may consider it as permission. By the first meaning, it's as a threatening from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So here, this is part of our inheritance from the previous prophets. This is part of the prophethood. This is significant character of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is part of our belief, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said al-haya'u min al-iman. I'm sorry to hear, you may correct me if wrong, you know, nowadays, because this character, you know, is not good, not considered as good character, you know, in the Western culture, you know. Some Muslims, they try to say there is shyness and haya, and they try to give difference between them or whatever, you know, of that regard. I cannot buy all of those matters, you know. What I understand, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said al-haya'u khayrun kullu. The only exception we may give to this, when we seek knowledge, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said rahim Allah nisa al-ansar lam yamna'hunna al-haya'u an yatafaqahna fi ad-din. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked to have the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the woman of Ansar, because even though they are shy, but this is not block them, you know, of seeking knowledge. And one commentator said that the major barrier or block between you and knowledge, they are two factors. When you are shy or when you are pride, you know, those matters will not make you, will not enable you to ask, you know, and get more information in this regard. This is the only place that I remember that you shouldn't be shy of, you know. Other than this point, whenever you are shy, whenever you have this khuluq, this is good, very good one, you know. And one day the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed through a person blaming his brother because he is too shy, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said leave him alone. Al-haya'u khayrun kulluh. Shyness, all of it is good. This about this hadith. Move to next one, insha'Allah. An Abi Amr, wa qila Abi Amrah, سفيان بن عبد الله الثقفي رضي الله عنه قال: قلت يا رسول الله، قل لي في الإسلام قولا لا أسأل عنه أحدا غيرك. قال: قل آمنت بالله ثم استقم. رواه مسلم.
Hadith 21 on the authority of Abu Amr, and he's also given as Abu Amrah, Sufyan ibn Abdullah, may Allah be pleased with him, who said, I said, O Messenger of Allah, tell me something about Islam which I can ask of no one but you. He said, say, I believe in Allah, and thereafter be upright. It was related by Muslim.
I would perhaps translate it, I'll not ask anyone else, no, to say, I'll be sufficient of needing anyone else. Give me an answer to make me sufficient, no need of asking anyone else. لا أسأل عنه أحدا غيرك. Okay, this is what I understand. Here, what I want, okay. Firstly, Sayyidina Sufyan ibn Abdullah al-Thaqafi is one of a famous tribe called Thaqif. Those people, you know, to start with, they were tough on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam a lot, and they were about to be the last one to become Muslim. Their representative came to Medina al-Munawwara on Ramadan year number 9. I'm giving you the date of this hadith, okay? Ramadan year number 9. So he was among those representative who came to Medina al-Munawwara. You see, I feel, I may imagine, those people, you know, when they got in touch with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and feel they are going to leave him shortly, for sure they are going to feel really bad, you know, about this. And they try to get the maximum of him sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Sayyidina Sufyan, he figured out, I'm going to be in need of many matters, you know. Let me ask the Prophet a matter to make me sufficient, you know, knows whatever is going to come to me. And that's what he asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And man utiya jawami' al-kalim told him, قل آمنت بالله, testimony about your belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then be straight forward, okay, steady in whatever. This we what we call istiqama, okay? And this istiqama, one of the major matters, you know. What I want to comment here, firstly, many of the companions, they may memorize a short surah or few verses of the Quran. They may convey few ahadith. Sayyidina Sufyan, he has 5 ahadith already from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So by theory, our knowledge is much better than many of the companions. But our practice is on the other hand, okay? So here, it's not the matter of the knowledge that you have been given, the quantity of it. It's the matter of how do you subject it to action? How do you make it work for you? And this is everything about it. I just imagine this companion, perhaps he did not need to ask anyone when he asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam this question, okay? And this istiqama is one of the major matters. Some interpreter, they said, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, shayyabatni hudun wa akhawatu, I think there's a famous man, he dreamt about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he told him that what make him have gray hair, even though the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam have only few, they were less than 20 hair, you know, in his holy beard and his hair, you know, of those white hair. And he asked the Prophet what did, in the dream, he said, Al-Istiqama, the verse which in Surah Hud, Fastaqim kama umirt. Okay, be steady, you know, steadfast, the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded you. And here tells us about the importance of istiqama. This reminded me of one day the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked the people who attended his majlis, whom among you will return back to my majlis in the same way, same hal, same state that he left the majlis. See? يعني they, we cannot, inshallah, we may test it, you know, when they sit with the Prophet, how you feel? How they feel about it? As if they are in the rank of the angels or of facing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This was described as such when they sit with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So here, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wants to upgrade their standards, you know, all the time he said, who among you, when he returned back to me, he will be in the same state when he left me. يعني he kept up. This is istiqama. يعني he was in the same state when he departed from the majlis of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Let's say he met with him next day or after week or after month or you name it. He will return back, keeping up his standard, you know, till he returned back to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Sayyidina Abu Dharr said, I am Ya Rasulullah. And he said, you are truthful. You are truthful. You see? And this tells us how important is istiqama. When we try to, when Ramadan comes, all of us, we are going to join the prayer and feel, have good time or whatever. But what's about keeping up this till the coming year? When you go to Hajj, all of us, we are going to feel ourselves, you know, close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But what's about keeping it till you meet with Allah again and you name it, okay? When you recite Quran, when you do this, when you have prayer and you name it. So how to gain this? I don't know exactly. I'm not the experienced person because I need a lot of istiqama. I'm still going back and forth, you know. So, but I'll tell you about this hadith, my understanding of this hadith. I may be right or wrong. The Prophet ﷺ said, "Istaqimu walan tuhsir." Be steadfast, and you are not going to be able to do it all the time. And this is the reality. Why? Because human, regardless of how sophisticated, how perfect is him, he's going to have period of coolness, let's say. وَعْلَمُوا بِأَنَّ أَفْضَلَ أَعْمَالِ الْمُؤْمِنِ الصَّلَاةِ. This one way of keeping up istiqama, to have plenty of prayer, okay? Do nafila. وَلَا يُحَافِظُ عَلَى الْوُضُوءِ إِلَّا مُؤْمِنِ. This is the other way of keeping istiqama, by keeping up yourself in the purification state on wudu, okay? I observe some of us, you know, they just always, all the time they are in that state of breaking wudu, you know, and just making wudu for prayer. Try, work hard to keep up in purification state all the time, okay? If you have problem in your stomach or belly, you should adjust your food, you know, because I know about many, you know, they eat a lot, you know, and then they have gas, they have this, they have that, you know, and some of them, I'm sorry, I'm going to tell everything, you know, some of them will say, am I excused, you know, I am ma'zur. I have been يعني asked by many of them, I am ma'zur. I am ma'zur for prayer, but I am not ma'zur for eating. Okay, so here, the point which highlighted, keep up your wudu all the time, and try to pray more to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay? By this, you may get istiqama from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And istiqama, in my mind, perhaps the best thing is that you are going to be given. Especially in our time. Because in our time, we have a lot of fitna. We have a lot of Muslims, you know, they convert back, nas'Allah salama. The Prophet ﷺ described this time as people in the morning they are believers, in the afternoon or in the evening they are non-believers. Why? Because they sold their religion. They sold their religion in a cheap price, you know, of this dunya, you know. So that's, يعني if the companions, they were in need of istiqama, we are in deep and much more great need, you know, of istiqama when you observe what's going on, you know. You see people, you see how the practice goes and you name it, okay. And one of the major barrier, as mentioned of some in some of these ahadith, love of dunya, as mentioned in the last hadith, you know, that's why. So here in this particular hadith, Imam al-Nawawi radiallahu anhu, who want to highlight to us the importance of istiqama. This has been mentioned as in the command form in two verses in the Quran, in Surah Hud and in Surah Ash-Shura. It has been mentioned in the description of those people in two surahs, in Surah Fussilat and in Surah Al-Ahqaf. Okay? And this is istiqama. Really, we are in real need of it. We should keep up. Anyone of you that felt when we spoke about Hadith Sayyidina Ibn Abbas, he's got some touchy points, you know, or some feeling, you know, that he get closer, keep up this, you know. Many may feel that, many may taste this, but very few those who keep up, you know, with those matters, you know. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never change, we change, you know. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He subhanahu wa ta'ala delivered this knowledge to us, you know, this is a significant generosity from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But sometimes we are lousy, we are useless, you know, we try to waste our treasures, you know, and try to look for the matter they are harmful to us, you know, and forget whatever is beneficial to us. Move to next hadith. طريق الجنة عن أبي عبد الله جابر بن عبد الله الأنصاري رضي الله عنهما أن رجلا سأل رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فقال أرأيت إذا صليت الصلوات المكتوبات وصمت رمضان وأحللت الحلال وحرمت الحرام ولم أزد على ذلك شيئا أأدخل الجنة؟ قال نعم. رواه مسلم. ومعنى حرمت الحرام اجتنبته، ومعنى أحللت الحلال فعلته معتقدا حله.
حديث 22 عن الأثري أبو عبد الله جابر the son of Abdullah al-Ansari may Allah be pleased with them both. A man asked the messenger of Allah may the blessings and peace of Allah be upon him. Do you think that if I perform the obligatory prayers, fast in Ramadan, treat as lawful that which is lawful, and treat as forbidden that which is forbidden, do nothing further, shall I enter paradise? He said, yes. It was related by this.
The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the messenger for the common, for everyone. Ya ayyuhan nas inni rasulullah ilaykum jami'a, for everyone. And that's why in one hand is going to show how simple and how easy it is to reach or to perform. And this hadith of that regard, when that person asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam about keeping up his prayer. I'm sorry to say, as we said yesterday, many of us, they miss prayer nowadays, you know. Okay, I'm going to pray all of them, you know, when I return back home. إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ كَانَتْ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ كِتَابًا مَوْقُوتًا. You have wasted your prayer. For sure, I'm instructing you to make them up, you know, but don't make this as an habit. It may as a habit. It may happen sometimes, you know, for some of us, you know, but shouldn't be as a habit, okay? You should keep up, and it's time. You have an appointment with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and there's nothing in this life much more than your appointment with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's what Sayyidah Aisha used to say when she was asked about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and she spoke how he used to be at home, you know, busy with the matter of his people, you know, or his family, you know, inside the house, and whenever they call up adhan, as if we don't know him, he doesn't know us. He's going to be a completely different person. Why? Because now he has an appointment with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay? And this is the meaning of iqamat al-salawat, to set it up, you know, and it's the time which was designated by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to those salawat, sumtu Ramadan, fasting Ramadan, and he kept himself, you know, believing in whatever halal and believing in whatever haram and try to avoid it. هل يدخل الجنة؟ نعم. It's very simple. It's very easy. Okay. On the other hand, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to encourage us. That's why he used to pray sunnah. That's why he used to speak about nafila. That's why he used to mention some certain reward, you know, for certain deeds, you know, which is not an obligation. And this, all of those matters, just to upgrade us and try to compete and try to reach higher and higher ranks, you know, in the hereafter, you know, in this regard. So there's no contradiction between the two aspects, you know, and the Prophet ﷺ was very excellent, you know, in both of these sides, you know, in this regard. The narrator of this hadith, Sayyidina Jabir ibn Abdullah al-Ansari, he is one of the, who has more than 1,000 hadiths. There are seven, you know, I think we mentioned most of them. We are left with Sayyidina Jabir and another one coming, inshallah, in 40 Nawawiyah. Sayyidina Jabir ibn Abdullah al-Ansari, he narrated 1,540 come in the sixth rank, you know, after Sayyidina Abu Huraira, Ibn Umar, Anas ibn Malik, Aisha, Ibn Abbas, and Jabir. Jabir number six, and we'll have number seven coming shortly, inshallah, either today or tomorrow. Sayyidina Jabir is one of the famous narrators. His father is again a companion. His father was killed in Uhud battle, okay, and was naqib. His father was, when they have the treaty with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Aqaba, he assigned 12 persons as supervisor or whatever, naqib, like supervisor or whatever, or chief among the Ansar. And from those 12, one of them was Abdullah ibn Amr ibn Haram, father of Sayyidina Jabir ibn Abdullah. And the Prophet ﷺ told the Ansar, let no one of you feel bad about it, because I'm going to assign those were appointed by Jibreel. And Sayyidina Jibreel told him, take this one, that one. Okay, so one of them was Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-Haram. We fully appreciate this person. Why? Because when Ghazwat Uhud, when Abdullah ibn Ubay take back 1/3 of the army of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, just imagine, you know, if you have 1,300 or more, they went back, your brothers and your people, you know, they are back. How hard is going to be in your heart when you have everyone leave and go back? And this, which I highly appreciate, saying Abdullah, he returned back asking, say, oh my people, please come back, you know, keep begging him, you know. And then when he felt that they will not listen to him, he said, go away, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to be sufficient for us, you know, we are in no need of you. Okay, and he returned back to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and was killed in that particular battle, you know. We should have full appreciation of what he has done, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu wa arda. Again, we have another companion called Jabir ibn Abdullah, another Jabir ibn Abdullah, one who attended the first meeting with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam with Ansar. This was 2 years before Bay'at al-Aqaba, when six of the Ansar, they met with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. One of them was Jabir ibn Abdullah. He is from the same section of this Jabir ibn Abdullah, Bani Salima, but a different person. And in one section of the Ansar, we have two persons they call Jabir ibn Abdullah. This is the most famous one. This one lived long life, alhamdulillah, after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He passed away year 78. Okay. Move to next hadith. عن أبي مالك حارث بن عاصم الأشعري رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم الطهور شطر الإيمان والحمد لله تملأ الميزان وسبحان الله والحمد لله تملأان أو تملأ ما بين السماوات والأرض والصلاة نور والصدقة برهان والصبر ضياء والقرآن حجة لك أو عليك كل الناس يغلو فبائع نفسه فمعتقها أو موبقها. رواه مسلم.
حديث 23 عن الأثورية أبو مالك الحارث بن عاصم الأشعري may Allah be pleased with him, who said, the messenger of Allah, may the blessing and the peace of Allah be upon him, said, purity is half of faith. Alhamdulillah, praise be to Allah, fills the scales. And subhanallah, how far is Allah from every imperfection? And alhamdulillah, praise be to Allah, fill that which is between heaven and earth. Prayer is light. Charity is a proof. Patience is illumination. And the Quran is an argument for or against you. Everyone starts his day and is a vendor of his soul, either freeing it or bringing about its ruin. It was related by Muslim.
This hadith is to explain facts, okay? And we say prayer, what is prayer? We say charity, what is charity? We say patience, we say Quran, we say this, we say that, you know? And in many occasions we don't know the reality of those matters, you know? And here we get it from the most pure resource, you know, to tell us about what's behind those matters, you know. And that's what I told you yesterday about a person, you know, collect all 40 hadiths of those matters, that when the Prophet ﷺ had the form of two words, you know, in the hadith, what we call it in Arabic, mubtada wa khabar, just to tell you about certain issues, you know. And here in this hadith, as you may see, you have a plenty of them. So here, really, we should put aside all our knowledge and try to understand what the Prophet ﷺ wants us to understand in those matters. So he starts speaking about purification. Okay, what is purification? It may be physical or non-physical. Okay, or maybe for both of them. Now we know prayer is one of our major pillar in Islam. Without purification, it's not valid. Okay, we have zakah. What is zakah? Zakah may contain two meanings. Meaning of growing up and meaning of purification. And here the zakah, it has the two meanings, you know. It's going to make your money come get more and more. And in the meanwhile, it's going to purify your money. Because the Prophet ﷺ in one hadith, he said, whoever did not pay or failed to pay his zakah, this is going to vanish his money. Why? Because his money contains a lot of dirt, you know. You purify your money, you know, by paying the portion of the zakah. This is make it purified. So here, purification, you may take it as the meaning for prayer, as the meaning of zakah, as the meaning of what? We have the first hadith, the intention, okay, an-niyyah. You are going to purify your intention, you know. And I'm not exaggerating if I said, you know, perhaps one of the significant difference among us, you know, that our intention will have different intention for different matters, you know, and we are going to be rewarded according to it. And in many occasions, this dirty intention, you know, needs to be purified, to be mukhlis, ikhlas, to be pure to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَمَا أُمِرُوا إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ مُخْلِصِينَ لَهُ الدِّينَ الْإِخْلَاصِ. That's why in Bab al-Ikhlas, they put the meaning of intention just to purify, to make anything that you are going to come to do or to practice or whatever, to purify it right, exactly, you know, before practicing it. I think we'll stop here, you know, this hadith needs some further talk, you know, some further explanation. Inshallah, we'll come back after.
Assalamu alaikum, everyone. I don't know if the heat is from all the faith in the room or just from the heat outside, but alhamdulillah, thank you for bearing with us. I know the guys are working hard on trying to find a solution to the heat. Subhanallah, it's a pretty warm day out there today, but even though we're in the basement, mashallah, it's still quite warm. Alhamdulillah, What we're going to do now is have Sheikh Muaz, don't go too far. Yeah, I know he's trying to run away.